Okay, Rosie was just telling us something about the ocean spray that was being used for cooking. Can you elaborate on that, Rosie?
Let's see, Anne has a question about, did you have a question?
Okay. The ocean spray is, the old people used to call it ironwood.
That's what you called it.
Yeah. And before the ironwood, before we lost our language, it was called ironwood. The ocean spray is a cooking tool that's used for many, many ways of cooking the proteins. Back in the day, mostly salmon. You take the ocean spray and find as straight a stick you can. You debark it, and you gotta this is where the beaver comes in handy. Kidding. You debark it and you split it, and you take the
marrow
out of the center, and you sand it and you sharpen it, and then you use that for either your filleted salmon. Like you kept going, you know,
skillet.
That's what you see. But you can also cut them into portion-sized pieces and then put them through the skewer.
All right, thank you.
And the ocean spray is like, I would say, halfway between a limb and a petrified wood.
Oh.
Because it don't burn.
Well, we were just talking about big leaf maple catkins, and you were saying something about what the medicinal value for them. Could you say that again for us, please?
The medicinal value for in plants is known to animals time immemorial, way before science. Mm-hmm. The plants were the medicine. And the medicine that, especially the four-legged house pets, they do not have an oral history, but they have that instinct. Mm. If most of us had an instinct and followed what our instincts were, we'd be in a better place.
Thank you. All right, well, we're here today and we're going to go through some photos, and Rosie is going to elaborate on some of the pictures that we're sharing. So
should we could start with this year one?
Yes, please.
So I was on Orcas Island here, and you'll see where my hands look true. They're not like this, you know. They're like this, you're like.
Okay. Two position?
Oh, yeah.
Either way you want, I honor you. Mm. I honor you. I honor you. Mm. You don't have to have much words in our language. We're mostly visual learners. You know, so this year was to an audience, I honor you. I'm not one to, how do I say it? I'm not one to gussy up to get attention. But I do like to use The shawl represents protection. When you're up in front of an audience, especially with some highly resentful one or two people in the crowd.
Mm-hmm.
You know, they're like, why are you telling this now when I was asked to go there and tell it? So you get people that register for the presentation, but they are, what is the word, narcissist?
Mm-hmm.
Or, yeah.
Hecklers?
Yeah. And they do, there was two at Kiwanis, that two guys, and they wanted to know about the schools, the boarding schools in Canada. And so, they wanted to know my take on that. And I was married to one of the guys who went to those schools. And to be able to still carry this here, gratitude towards all the people, and to have all the generational trauma we had, and still be accepting of anybody from 0 to 100, I would have given those guys a 2. The 2 just for walking in the door and sitting down. The rest of it, I don't have. No. The rest of it, I used a lot of humor, and everybody laugh, and negative spirits don't like humor.
Mm-hmm.
So sooner or later their irritation was getting lesser and lesser. I didn't have any, I had protection.
The shawl.
Yeah. So I didn't feel like my spirit was trespassed upon, because I had protection.
Okay, thank you. That's beautiful.
So here is a crew, 2, 4, 6, 8, yep, 11-man canoe. I always do that because maybe some of the guys didn't make it to the photo. So 11-man canoe is a game, like a sport.
Mm-hmm.
You have the 11-man canoe that they compete against each other, and everybody wins because they got there. They made it,
yeah.
You know. And so this year, when every one of these here paddles are made, handmade by with either Alaskan or red cedar. You wouldn't want to use alder or madrona because it's heavy.
Oh, yeah.
And even Alaskan is a little bit heavier than the red cedar. I couldn't tell you what tribe this is, but every tribe has a 11-man canoe.
Takes a lot of coordination when there's that many people in one canoe.
There is, and it takes a lot of, there is today. There wasn't back then. Back then it was nature.
More intuitive?
Yeah.
Hmm.
Okay, and what year do you think that was?
Oh, sure.
No, it's fine. What year do you think that was?
I think this is probably in the maybe 45,
okay.
I'm guessing, as per, how do you say that, per attire?
Mm-hmm.
Per attire, I'm thinking 45 or 50, and their hair. here is my grandpa on the left, who was born here on Guaymas. And this year was in the 60s, around 65. 68. It was 1968. Because my little cousin there was born in 67. And she was born in December, so this has to be 68. And the young man way over to the left had just gotten home from Vietnam. And my grandpa, who was born here, was Coast Salish, as I am. I've never said, I probably have when I'm representing a tribe, I will say, you know, like, and I'm Samish, but then I go down a lineage. Because I can't just say I'm Samish and my ancestors hear me not notice that they're tribes. My grandma was born at Swinomish, but she's also Samish. Her her grandpa was a leader in many villages. And grandpa, in this year one, I think he's 70. Yeah, he's 70 years old here.
There's a smile in his face and in his eyes.
In my grandpa?
Yes.
Oh, he was a gorgeous man. He never shaved. I laid on his chest and plucked his whiskers with the tweezers.
Oh my gosh.
Yeah. And then every now and then he'd go, oh! And he'd scare me and I'd laugh. He'd laugh at me and I said, Grandpa, if you want your whiskers plucked, then you have to quit scaring me.
What did he do for work?
My grandfather was a man of very little means to survive. He could survive on anything. Mm-hmm. He survived by helping build fish traps. When the modern nets come around, he showed them how to place floats on. The old nets were made of fiber from nettles and, and roots. But then you gotta remember, these here nets, because they get brittle from salt, they had to make them every year.
That was a winter project, wasn't it?
It was, because you had many, many, even children, many, how do I say this, people who helped build that net, to help create it. And you got to think of the net being at least 22 feet deep to catch salmon and bottom fish.
A lot of twine.
It was. And so there's like 10 or 11 villages that took a portion, and then at the end they got together and then they sewed them together. That's why I say oral history. Is being a lost art today. The man that I learned from is right there, right there. The man that I learned from was born in the 1800s.
In the old ways.
Old history. Yeah. The man he learned from was born in the early 1800s. And then to him and then to me. And because because of today's modern tech and modern this and modern that, you're not going to catch a lot of oral history anymore. Grandma, Grandma took care of a lot of the labor that it took to bring home the protein, whether it be the duck, the deer, the clams, the crab, the bottom fish. Grandma took care of that. Grandpa was the hunter, the fisher, the protector.
So they were traditional roles.
They were traditional roles. There was nothing, there was no modern job that Grandpa did except for what he knew, and he helped. He helped the tribe build their fish trap. And if you go back into the history of Swinomish, you'll see the fish traps. Mm-hmm. And you go back into the history of my grandpa, my great uncle, Henry Caillou. Now, these are two of the wisest, most humble fishermen I've ever seen in the same pictures together. Mm-hmm. Ever. I've never seen these together. And they both come from the same humble life, except for that my great granduncle, he died. State representative. And a millionaire. But he had nothing to do with $1 million. What is there to do when I like the way I am? Mm-hmm. What is $1 million going to do for me? You know? You hear that? Mm-hmm. What was it?
That was just a chair.
Oh.
Yeah, that's kind of a noisy chair.
When you'd be with your...
Ooh, this is a cool... I've never seen this picture.
When you would be with your grandfather clucking his whiskers... I wonder, I had a grandmother who sang. And I had another grandmother who didn't speak much at all because of the grandfather. Mm-hmm. I wonder, other than plucking its whisker, what was a typical time with them? Working, helping grandmother do things?
I did a lot of working with my grandfather.
Can you do that?
They did a lot of, how do I want to say this?
There. Okay, wait. Yes. Okay.
Thank you. They did a lot of their work together. We've done. Grandma would, Grandma mostly sat in the car when we were working with Grandpa. And she knitted while she was waiting. And she contributed to the table by selling her socks for $5 a pair, which now Cowichan socks go for $1.25.
Mm-hmm. So, Rosie, can you explain this picture?
This is a longhouse. In this longhouse, people lived here. And these are invited tribes. In our day and age of this era, if you hear about it, you are invited. Mm-hmm. It's never RSVP or anything. It's kind of like a silly... I get offended by, I guess, you invited me, why do I have to tell you I'm coming? You know, blah, blah, blah. I'm just funny that way, because of this. Mm-hmm. Some of these people heard about it in Vancouver Island.
So where is this taken?
I believe this year is on Whidbey Island.
Mm. And are those drums?
They are drums. Like in the back, straight mm-hmm. back, yeah. And the ancestors here, when they came into the home of the people who hosted this. You see the little benches in front of them. They're sitting on a bench. There's a reason why people are not sitting in the front, and I have not ever even thought of that.
Well, it looks like, see, they have sticks. Mm-hmm. Are they using those sticks to make, you know, to do a beat?
Yeah. So, before all these people came, there's partitions from cattail mats. Mm. Like there's 20, 30 people. This is just one end of that longhouse. This year longhouse could be 120 feet long. I don't know that. I gather these year pictures from some of my cousins who have these pictures in their library. You see the beams up there? Mm-hmm. And one thing is you don't see in there is litter or anything. There was no litter on any properties that these natives own, unlike today's. Today's generations have lost all aspects of how to be with the sacred soil. Look how dark that soil is. That's nearly... this year could be a new home, because generally the floors are so so used and so walked on that they look waxed. Mm-hmm.
Again, those beams are amazing.
Indian pot, yes. And the rose candy, 1904.
That's why I was thinking the other one was was Whidbey Island as well.
So those cross beams would have the partitions when you weren't having everybody there? You said cattail.
No, there was material.
Yeah.
See where that first guy is?
Yes.
On the left, down to the next guy who's kind of up.
Up a little, yeah.
So they had partitions made from wood beams.
Okay.
And made of cattail, made of needle twine that held the cattails together, mm-hmm. and cedar bark that is also made mats from. Now you'll see in here, see all those piled blankets there?
Yes, over here.
That's part of the... That's part of the potlatch. here they had giveaways, and people brought gifts. And in my interpretation of this year, again, I'm seeing a new longhouse. See the color of the wood, that they're not dark brown.
Mm-hmm.
So the potlatch, in my interpretation of this year, this photo is, those blankets can very well be made from woolly dog.
Mm.
And have you heard of woolly dog?
Yes, indeed. I just saw something recently about that in research at the Burt Museum.
Oh yeah, I was on that board for a while.
Yeah.
See, now looking in the very back by the door, now I couldn't figure out that person for the longest time, so I just give up wondering who, what, and where these here peoples with hats on were in a proper manner there. Because in our manner, if you're wearing a hat, it is supposed to either have a feather on it, or it had to be made of cedar.
Mm.
So back in 1904, when things started to get modern, they switched over to these sorts of hats, and that was way back in 1904, 120 years ago.
Yeah, that's amazing.
Thank you.
That's my grandfather again, who was born on this island. The stake is for nets that go out into a big circle.
Yeah.
It's called a beach seine. And in my lifetime, my crew have caught 5,000 in one set.
Whoa.
5,000. Before that was Grandpa's cousin, who had caught 2,000, 2,500. But I happened to be very, very blessed that day. Very honored by the Creator to have that many salmon be caught in one set. It took us 1 hour and 20 minutes to get the salmon out of the net and into the loader.
I bet.
Oh my gosh.
Because we had to sort it at the same time.
Yeah, a lot of work.
It was pinks, coho, king salmon, steelhead, crab, flounders, you know, you name it. That's how our old people survived us through the plant nets and traps.
And who are the people on the right?
The people on the right are my auntie. The one in the front, I believe, is Billy Chevalier or Charlie Chevalier, maybe. But these two people were born and raised on Friday Harbor in their ancestral homeland. And intermarried. You can see most native in the man.
Mm-hmm.
But that there is his mom and his sisters, and they still have family out on Friday Harbor that I comfort all the time, because they lost their lineage. They lost their lineage information.
Mm-hmm.
So they weren't able to. You can see a lot of the native and the lady on the left too. There is a Mitchell Bay tribe out there that became I can't say unrecognized, because I still know who they are. So they lost their status as a tribe.
Mm. Hmm.
These here ones, I can't say who they are, what they're doing. Back in the days before that, the ancestors didn't allow